Time Warner Audiobooks presents Till Death Do Us Part, written by Kate White and read by Kate Walsh.
The first time she said her name on the phone that January night, I couldn't place her, though there was something vaguely familiar about the voice. It had a snooty, trust fundy tone, as if she were announcing, "I own a Marc Jacobs bag and you don't."
"Ashley Haynes,"
she said once more, this time with exaggerated emphasis and irritation.
"We met at Peyton Cross's wedding. I was a bridesmaid, remember?"
"Oh, right." We had been introduced late last April in Greenwich, Connecticut, during the infamous Cross-Slavin wedding weekend. Ashley had graduated from the same exclusive private high school as the bride and was now working, if my memory was correct, as an interior decorator in Greenwich, though working was apparently something she chose rather than had to do. An image of her began to loosen from my memory: long, chestnut-colored hair, slim as a French baguette, and haughty as hell.
"Oh, right, I'm so sorry," I said. "I'm in a little bit of a fog at the moment. How are you, anyway?"
I was pretty sure what was coming next. Since I'm a contributing writer for Gloss magazine, I often get phone calls from people I've met asking for fashion or publishing-related favors. But I write gritty true crime and human interest stories for the magazine, and I'm not connected to the glittery, glossy stuff. "My name is Bailey Weggins, and just for the record, I am categorically unable to help someone become a Ford model, gain admittance to a Chanel sample sale, or publish a confessional article on how a liposuction procedure left ugly scars along her buttocks."
"I need your help," she said. "There's a very serious situation, and I have to talk to you about it."
Serious to someone like Ashley could mean her hairstylist was out of town for the week, but the alarm in her voice sounded real enough that I was concerned. "Is it about Peyton?" I asked. Though I had spoken to Peyton on the phone once last summer, I had not laid eyes on her in 9 months, not since she had dazzled a room of 500 guests in a satin Vera Wang wedding dress with a low-cut crumb-catcher bodice. From there, she had headed off for a cruise of the Greek islands with her new, older husband, David, who'd made a fortune in the world of finance, whatever that means.
"No, well, indirectly, yes. Look, it's not something I want to get into on the phone. Can you meet me to talk about this?"
"All right. Tell me when. And where? Are you still living up in Greenwich?"
"Yes, but I'm in New York tonight at the Four Seasons Hotel. Could you come by here for a drink?"
"Tonight?" I exclaimed. It had started to snow a few hours earlier, and as I glanced across the room toward the terrace of my 14th-story apartment, I could see it was coming down harder now, in big, crazy swirls. I live at the very eastern end of Greenwich Village, on the corner of 9th Street and Broadway, and it would be a bitch getting a cab up to 57th Street in this weather.
"It's urgent," she said. "When you hear what I have to say, you'll understand why I need to see you immediately."
It didn't seem that I had much choice but to acquiesce. If the situation really did involve Peyton Cross, even indirectly, I was curious to know what it was. I explained to Ashley that it might take me 45 minutes to get there. We agreed that I would ring her on the hotel house phone when I arrived and she'd come down to the bar in the lobby. I'd been reading a book when she called, dressed in bagged-out sweatpants and drinking a cup of instant hot cocoa in honor of the snowstorm. And now I was going to have to head out into the mess. Several months ago, I'd moved into a steady relationship with a guy named Jack Herlihy, but because he taught psychology at Georgetown University in Washington, D.C., we saw each other on weekends. Some nights I'd see a movie or have dinner out with friends, but more weeknights than not, I was holed up in my apartment, either alone or chatting with my 70-year-old next-door neighbor, Landon. I changed into a pair of tight dark jeans, a black turtleneck sweater, and my snow boots. I was surprised when I stepped outside to see that about 2 inches of snow had already stuck to the ground, and you could tell by the swollen look of the sky that more was on the way. I opted for the subway, the number 6 train at Astor Place. As the train hurtled through the tunnel, I had time to consider what trouble might be brewing for the captivating Peyton Cross. From all reports, her life couldn't have been going better. In her early 30s, like me, she'd recently been dubbed the next Martha Stewart. She ran a combination cooking school, successful catering business, and gourmet kitchen and food shop out of an old farmhouse and barn, known as Ivy Hill Farm, on the outskirts of Greenwich. Her first cookbook was due out sometime this year, and she was a frequent guest on the Food Network. The last I'd heard, her new husband was funding the construction of a TV studio on her farm so she could produce her own show. As they say, I knew her when. She was my roommate freshman year at Brown. She was extremely vivacious, pretty in that kind of scrubbed face, not overly sophisticated, preppy way, and from what I could tell, afraid of absolutely nothing. Life as her roommate was entertaining, but also exasperating. That's because she could be selfish and rude. She'd ask me to meet her at dinner and then make me wait for an hour in the cafeteria. Or she'd borrow my best shirt and then leave it balled up with the dust bunnies under her bed. Over time, I figured out how to avoid situations with her that could end in me cursing under my breath. We both got single sophomore year, and though we were friendly and occasionally grabbed a beer together, we didn't see a huge amount of each other. I bonded with several women who, unlike Peyton, seemed to carry the good girlfriend gene. After college, Peyton and I stayed in touch by email. After gigs as a reporter for the Albany Times Union and the Bergen County Record, I headed for Manhattan, hoping to break into magazines. I called her for some insight. At the time, she was working for Food and Wine, developing recipes. She promised to introduce me to a few people in the business, and to my surprise, she actually came through. She also invited me to Greenwich several times for parties she was throwing as part of her burgeoning catering and event planning business. That was the thing about Peyton. Just when you're ready to strangle her, she could charm the pants off you. Her wedding had been one of the more lavish I'd ever attended. It was held in a historic house on the outskirts of Greenwich, and Peyton arranged for her own company to do the catering. That was partly because she didn't trust anyone else to do the job, but also for the PR value for her business. Friends of mine had sworn I'd bag some rich guest that day, but David Slavin was 15 years older than Peyton, and his business associates and friends were paunchy and pathetically boorish. I'd spent a good chunk of the day flirting with one of the bartenders. The snow was coming down even harder when I emerged from the underground at 59th and Lexington. I felt relieved when I finally stomped into the marble, two-story-high lobby of the Four Seasons. I rang Ashley's room to tell her I'd arrived and then headed over to the lobby bar, requesting the most private table they could manage. Though I hadn't recalled Ashley's name when she first said it on the phone, I had no trouble recognizing her as soon as she strode purposefully in my direction. Several heads turned to watch her. She had a rich girl's air of self-importance and entitlement, the kind that many A-list actresses try for years to acquire but never do. As she got closer, I realized that the dark plum thing she was wearing was actually a fur coat. Either she was planning on going out afterward, or she'd been reluctant to leave it in the room. It was, I suspected, sheared beaver or mink, lush and plush and worth at least $20,000. I wondered if her car sported a bumper sticker that read, "I don't break for small animals." She slid into the chair to my left without bothering with a perfunctory air kiss or even a hello. I guess she figured we'd gotten our pleasantries out of the way on the house phone. She wore her chestnut hair pinned back tonight, accentuating the slenderness of her tanned face. Her cheekbones were so high and sharp you'd risk a paper cut if you got too close to them. "Did you order yet?" she asked briskly, shaking off her coat to reveal a sleeveless orange dress and thin buff arms. She glanced at my turtleneck and jeans with a soupçon of disapproval, as if I were wearing one of those plastic lobster bibs that says, "I'm a piggy." No, I was waiting for you. She jerked her head around toward the center of the room and signaled for the waitress. She appeared on edge. There didn't seem to be any reason to spend 5 minutes on small talk, so as soon as she had ordered a dirty martini and I'd asked for a glass of Cabernet, I jumped in. "So tell me, what's going on?"
"When was the last time you spoke to Peyton?"
It's been a while. Last summer, I guess."
"Do you remember the bridesmaid with the short black hair, Jamie Howe?"
Jamie. She was the bridesmaid I'd spent the most time talking to, mainly because she was also in the magazine business. She'd met Peyton during her tenure at Food & Wine and had since become an editor at another food magazine. I hadn't particularly liked her. She was sullen and, I suspected, jealous of Peyton's success. Sure, she lives here in New York, right? Lived.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.